Okay, I'm very happy to introduce our last speaker before our coffee break, Pierre Montmartre, also from Paris, and he was talking about velocity jump processes.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you for the organizer for this nice workshop, under this nice weather and with all these nice people. So I'm going to present a class of kinetic processes that comes from stochastic algorithm motivation. So let's do some stochastic algorithms. It's the only slide about that, so stay with me. You'll have some kinetic equation in a minute, I promise. So first, the motivation is that, okay, you have some chemist or physicist or statistician that come to you and say, okay, I have this probability measure. I want to compute expectations with respect to this probability measure. Unfortunately, it's large dimensional, okay, so, and I know that this probability low is proportional to some exponential minus u, so I call u the potential. I can compute u, but I have no idea of the normalizing constant, it's out of track. So what you can typically do in that case is define a Markov process which is ergodic with respect to your measure, in the sense that if you do an average over time along a trajectory, then this average is going to converge in large time toward the statistical average, so the expectation you want to compute. So you can do that with many Markov processes, and in fact you can do that with kinetic processes. So you can add velocity, which is an auxiliary variable. You don't really care about the equilibrium of the velocity, so you just choose any law that you want. Okay, and you want a process which is ergodic with an equilibrium, which has a particular structure, which is that at equilibrium, position and velocities are independent, and the position is distributed according to your target law. So that if this process as a whole is ergodic with respect to this measure, then you will still have the same. If you take an observable here, phi, that depends only on the position, then you'll get the same result as before. Okay, so why would you want to use a velocity process instead of a Markov process only with x? So there are different possible answers. I won't go too into the details, but the main idea, I think, is that the problem of Markov processes is that they are Markov processes, and so they have no memory. And the problem here, what are you trying to do here? You're trying to explore the space, a high-dimensional space, with possibly complicated geometry given by this potential, and you want to explore it in such a way that at some time you've seen more or less any significant, statistically significant place. Okay, when you have mixed here, it means that you've seen all the places where there is some mass in pi. So there is really a problem of exploration, and you're exploring the space with an amnesic explorer. So you have a Markov process, he's seeing some place, then he moves, and then he completely forgot that it has already been there, and so the next step he can come there and say, okay, it is a lovely place, but he never learned that he's already been somewhere. And here velocity is the simplest way to have a bit of memory, because when you have a velocity, you know where you are, and you know where you are just about to go. And so you can continue with some inertia in the same direction for some time. And that there are really toy models where you can really check that the convergence toward equilibrium, which is again the speed at which you explore space in some sense, is really improved by the fact that you have some velocity or you have something non-reversible somewhere. Okay, so there is some heuristic reason to try and do so kinetic processes. Moreover, in some examples I'm going to introduce you, I'll come back to this maybe later, but you can have exact simulation, okay, meaning that there is no discretization bias, because if you suppose that here it's some diffusion, then you have to do some Euler scheme, and so you'll have some bias. So sometimes for some velocity processes there is some trick that that make exact simulation possible. And also the last reason is maybe the historical reason why people started doing that, because the first kinetic MCMC, in fact, is just molecular dynamics of Adler in like the 50s. So the motivation was to simulate molecular motion. So it was completely natural to use Newton's law and to do an Hamiltonian system and to do that. Okay, so sometimes your computing expectation, which are given by a model like molecular dynamics, which is kinetic, and so you, at least people from the field are more comfortable with the fact that the model something that have some sense for them. Okay, but from my point of view, which will be the point of view of the talk, we don't care about the real world. Okay, so maybe it's a usual statement for some of you, but here we can say it out loud. We don't really care what is the motivation behind this. Okay, any Markov process that does that is good for me. I don't care that it doesn't reproduce what made me want to compute things with that. Okay, this will have some consequences later on. Okay, so these are our specifications. We want to define a Markov process, so position velocity, meaning that the derivative over time of position is velocity. And the only thing we want to enforce is that the equilibrium is exactly given by that. So here, I could choose another equilibrium for the velocity, but I'll keep the Maxwellian here. So like that, I have a Gibbs measure associated to an Hamiltonian. It's not so important, but anyway. Okay, so there are many ways to do that. So here, when I talk to chemists, the velocity is not called the velocity, it's a momentum and it's written P. When I speak with probabilists, with some probability, the velocity is denoted Y. And here, I'm with people from kinetic theory, so I tried to write the velocity V. So if I write a Y somewhere, you have to put it in a V. And I tried to write the equations on the density of particles, which is not what I do usually. But I failed because I denoted rho, and I realized on the previous talk that rho should be only, so rho should be F, and rho should be the density only on position. Okay, so I'm very sorry, I tried. Okay, so we have three classical examples. The first one is just the Hamiltonian dynamics. Okay, so each time you have the transport part here, each time you have some force coming from the potential U. And then if you just do the Hamiltonian dynamics, let's say you take the Gaussian probability measure, meaning you take quadratic U, then you know that you have a harmonic oscillator, and it's not going to explore all the space. So you have to add some randomness on the velocity, and here are two very classical ways. So we have already met this equation quite a few times up to now. So either So you can call that the kinetic Fokker Planck or the Langevin or the Underdone Langevin, depending on where you come from. So here in this room, it's more a kinetic Fokker Planck, let's say. Or you have the Boltzmann, linear Boltzmann here, or BGK, I don't know. So here you have some diffusion or Schellenbeck on the velocities, and here you have at some constant rate, you just refresh the velocity, you take a completely new velocity drawn according to the equilibrium. Okay, so all those things do that. Okay, so you have a kinetic process and it samples the correct law, and the two last ones are ergodic. Okay, and we can also add a fourth specification, which is that we could want the velocity to be piecewise constant. And if you want the process to be Markov, then so you have a piecewise constant velocity, meaning that the motion is straight for some time. And so the only thing that you have to say now is that at some random time, the velocity jumps to another thing. And so because you're Markov, the jump time is necessarily given by a jump rate, which is the instantaneous probability that you jump, given that, so this is lambda, given that you are at some point, position y with some velocity w. And then you have to decide where you jump, so what is your next velocity, and this is given by a kernel, a probability kernel. Here it's q ywxv is the probability given that I jump when I am at position y with the velocity w, to okay, so here it's too general. In fact, the position will not jump, so I only have to take a new velocity, I don't have to take a new position here. So here y should be x, and there shouldn't be any x here. So, well, anyway. Okay, so now you have a motion which is piecewise by straight lines. Okay, so maybe call that a run and tumble because it's what happened in this kind of motion appears in the modeling of motion of bacterium. So it goes back to essentially a paper of Erban and Otmer in the beginning of in the 20s, I guess, in the 2000s. I don't know how you say it, how we say in English, but anyway. And then there has been some works by Vincent Calvez and his co-authors from the PD part and of Malrieux and others from the probability part. But here, I really want to emphasize that, again, we don't care about the real world. So we have it's not that we are given rates and kernels from observation of like bacterium or anyway, I don't know what. And then we have to compute an equilibrium which has no reason to be of a tensor form, position, time, velocity. And in fact, it's typically not the case for a run and tumble coming from modeling. Here, we have this probability and we have to choose as we want the kernel, the jump rate and the jump kernel. So I'm going to essentially present one way to enforce this equilibrium, which is what we can call bounce mechanisms. So so the jump rate is this, okay? So I take the scalar product of the velocity and the gradient of the potential, and I take the positive part of all that, okay? So this is, I'm going to give some interpretation of what it means, but okay, let's buy this for now. So this is my jump rate, and when I jump, my new velocity is deterministic, okay? The jump kernel is a Dirac mass at this or xv, which is in fact the orthogonal reflection of v with respect to the gradient of u. Okay, so you arrive at some point x with some velocity v, you jump and you jump to this new velocity. So at the end, the process is the following. So you have some free transport at constant speed here for some time up to random time, and the low of the random time at which you jump is given by the rate in this way. Okay, so you have the cumulative one minus the cumulative distribution of t, which is given by, in fact, you accumulate your jump rate along this trajectory. Okay, and another way to see this is to say that the low of the first jump, the next jump time, is given by this. So at the beginning of the motion, you draw an exponential variable e, okay? And this is going to be the amount of jump rate that you can accumulate. So now you run the trajectory, so this straight line, you accumulate this jump rate, okay, this is a positive thing. So this is increasing, and at some point, at some time t, this reaches the value e that you had drawn at the beginning, and it means, okay, now you jump. Okay, so what does this lambda and this r mean? Okay, lambda is the positive part of this thing. So v is the derivative over time of the position. So v scalar the gradient of u is in fact the derivative over time of u of xt. Okay, so if you integrate in time the derivative in time, you get the differences of the potential. Except that there is a positive part here. So this is true only as long as the potential is increasing along the trajectory. So as long as uxt is increasing, the accumulated jump rate is equal to the differences of the current energy minus the beginning. And this is zero if this is negative, and so when the process goes down to potential, you have probability zero to jump. Okay, so let's see, you start with the process here with some velocity directed in this way, and so it's going to go on a straight line, so it's going to see one-dimensional potential. And as long as it goes, so at the beginning, the process draw a random variable with an exponential low, standard exponential low, and it starts going. He accumulates, so he measures the energy barrier that is going up. When it's going down, nothing happens. And at some point, the sum of all these energy barriers will reach the value he that the process had drawn at the beginning, and that means that he has to jump. So that means he's not going in the good direction, and so he goes back. So this is the one-dimensional picture. Now, if we look at this picture from above, So we have the potential, we have the level sets of the potential, and at some time the process will jump, and I said the new velocity is the reflection, the orthogonal reflection of the arriving velocity with respect to the gradient of the potential. And the gradient of the potential is orthogonal to the level set of the potential. And that means, in fact, that when you jump, you are reflected like a BR, so with a specular reflection on the level set. So another way to see that is that, so you think that your particle are at each time, that each time there is an energy barrier, there is a some probability that a hole appears in front of the particle. So each time there is an energy barrier, the process Foucault-Cohen and the Swiss probability goes through the wall, and at some time the wall is rigid and the particle bounces on the wall. Okay, so this is just some interpretation. Anyway, you can sample this process. The problem is that if you only do that, okay, if you only have free transport plus this jump rate and this jump kernel, then you are not necessarily harmonic, meaning that you won't explore all the space, or in other words, meaning that the law at IT is not going to converge toward the equilibrium, so there may be several equilibrium. And it's very easy to see on the, let's say, the Gaussian in dimension 2. So the level sets are circles centered at the origin. And you see that as long as the process is going, so here is going down to potential, so there is a probability zero to jump. And at some point it's going to be tangent to some circle. And that's starting from this point, the process has some probability to jump. Then it jumps at some point, let's say here, and because there is some symmetry, in fact, so it's going to be reflected orthogonally to this line here, okay? So it's going to go there, and again, it's going to have a probability zero to jump up to this time. And then again, it can jump, but you see that this circle, in fact, is the same. Okay, it's always going to be tangent at the same circle, and it's never going to enter this circle. So if you run this process for very long, you'll see a hole in the center of the space where you've never been. And so, a simple way to deal with that is just to add a BGK term if you wish. So at some point, at random time, at constant rate, you just threw away your current velocity and you take a whole new velocity drawn according to the Maxwellian, and now the process is ergodic. It has a correct inbound measure. So here, typically, as I said before, you can do an exact simulation. You don't have to discretize the process. And the reason is that, in some sense, it's already discretized, because you already have some particular times where something happens. And when nothing happens, you don't have to record it anywhere. Okay, you just have to know where you are when you jump. And then you know that in between you are doing straight lines. And so, the only thing you have to do is to do an exact simulation of the time at which you jump. And this is possible even without computing integral of the jump time, of the jump rate, sorry. Because there is some probabilist method, which is called the thinning for Poisson processes, which is that if, for instance, you have your jump rate, and if you know that this jump rate, in fact, is less, okay, let's say that's some constant, but if it's not a constant, if it's some bound depending on time, but for which you can compute the analytically the integral of that guy, and then you can sample jump times with this rate, and then you have some you propose too many jumps, okay, with a rate too large, and then you have some probability to accept a jump or not. So this can be done very easily, and so you have an exact simulation of the jump times, and so of the process without bias from a discretization of final order scheme. Okay, so this can be interesting in some cases. Okay, and last remark here, I only presented what is sometimes called the bouncy particle sampler, which is the process where you only have one jump mechanism with this rate, and the kernel, which is the reflection, but there are many variants, so I will come back to the zigzag later, but when there is with the same jump rate, you could have randomized bounces, meaning that you could have some random new velocity instead of just deterministically jump into the reflection. Okay, but I won't go into these details. Just a few results, I won't be wrong about that. So for instance, in dimension 1, everything is completely explicit. So you can, for instance, have Ehring-Kramer's formula. So at here, the potential is you have some temperature, epsilon, and you want to understand how the process escapes from local minima at small temperature. And so you start from the local minimum here. You want to get out from this well, and it's going to be very long because the temperature is very low, and so you have an asymptotic of the expected time, which is okay, it's large because you have something over epsilon here with some prefactor. Just if you are used to classical Ehring-Kramer's formula, just note that there is no Hessian, there is no derivative at the exit point, contrary to what happens to the classical reversible diffusions. Because since you have inertia, if you reach x1, then you're going to cross. While the reversible process, when it's close to x1, then it has some probability to go down, and this probability depends on how curved is the spot here. And so here it doesn't happen, because if you reach x1, you just cross. Okay, and you can also prove a long-time convergence with Harris, Main2D, Fosbury-Lyapunov, choose your reference methods. It's not, so you need these methods have already been quoted in other talks, but so you need a Lyapunov function that tells you that you come back to a compact set. It's not completely trivial, because since you have non-local terms, you can't, okay, you have some region of the space that you are going to leave because you are going to change your velocity. You have some region of space when you are going to leave because the potential is going to decrease or increase or whatever. So you have different reasons to leave different regions of spaces, but when you are going to define your Lyapunov function, when you define it somewhere, it's going to have consequences in many other places because the operator is non-local. So it's not completely very nice and simple, but anyway, we can do that, for instance, with potential that grows like polynomial in sense of the norm. And then, just a remark here, so you have two ingredients in this kind of method. First, you go back to compacts, and then in compacts, you can couple two processes, starting in different positions to be at the same position after some time. And the easiest way to do that is to have a Dobbin condition, which is that starting from some point, you have some probability to, you have some control on the Lebesgue measure or something like that. And usually this is not so explicit. And here, it's not what we do. We do an explicit coupling, really, of two processes. In fact, we only use the refreshment, so the PGK part, if you will. And then, so we couple explicitly two PGK processes. And then we just say that there is some probability that in the meanwhile there is no jump due to the bounce part. Okay, so this argument is completely general. You take any velocity jump process with some rate that you don't really know and some constant refreshment, and you can do exactly what we did here. Okay, and we don't have the correct rate. Okay, if again you're interested in small temperature asymptotics, we just have that the rate is exponentially bad with epsilon, which is what we can expect, but we don't have the correct constant theta here. That should be the worst energy barrier you have to cross, etc. But here our estimates are a bit rough, so we don't have that. Okay, so I don't want to go into details on the result. I want to say how from this unique mechanism, which is the bounce mechanism, in fact you can create a whole family of kinetic processes that are all designed to have your target measure as an equilibrium, which is the factorization method. So let's look at the generator of the process. So it's just the dual of the operator involved in the evolution of your density here. And okay, I can decompose it in three things. So first you have the transport part, which is the only part that acts on the position. all the other things are only concerned the velocity, and you have some dissipation here. So in the first slide, it was either in the Fokker-Planck case, it was some Ornstein-Lundbeck processes on the velocities. It's either the bouncy particle or the Boltzmann. It's some refreshment, relaxation, non-local term. Okay, but anyway, it's anything that only acts on the velocity and which is reversible with respect to your velocity. So it's just some thermalization, mixing, anyway. And then, so this part does not involve the target. Okay, the target is given by our potential U, and it's neither in the transport nor in this dissipation. So everything here is in this F operator, so F for forces anyway. And you can check that if this condition is satisfied, then you will have, so if you integrate that with this equation with respect to the probability, the equilibrium in x, which is pi of x, so exponential minus u, then you will get that, in fact, if you integrate by part here you will get t phi, and here you have, well, minus t phi, and here you would have f. So that, so when you integrate that, you get that the integral of L phi with respect to mu is zero, meaning that mu is in equilibrium. So here, this implied that mu is in equilibrium. And this condition, you can see that, okay, here this is the Maxwellian, so it's you choose it, okay, it's completely independent from the target measure. And so the target measure here only appears with this gradient of u, and you see that this is a condition which is linear with the gradient of u. And it means that if I decompose the gradient of u in several vector fields, okay, and if I consider operators that satisfy the same condition here, except that I replace gradient u by this xi, then of course when I do the sum of the operator fi, I'm going to satisfy the previous condition, okay, because I'm just going to sum up these equalities and it will give me the previous equality. Okay, and so I have two examples of operators that do that. So there is the drift, which is the classical one that appeared in the Hamiltonian dynamics, kinetic Fokker-Planck and Boltzmann. And now I've introduced a new process, a new operator, which is the bounce operator. Okay, and you see that both the drift and the bounces only depend. So if you look at the original one, they only depend on gradient of u. Okay, so if I decompose gradient of u on different vector fields, and I take the same as before, but when I replace everywhere, so every time I add a gradient u, I replace it by xi e, then it's completely trivial to check that this is still true. Okay, so here what I call or xi I is the reflection orthogonally to the vector field xi I. Okay, so here. So I can split the gradient and do different parts with different things. And you see that when I didn't have the bounce, if I only had the drift, then I could do nothing with that, because if I split gradient of u and I do different operators, drift operators, and then I sum them up, but, well, this operator is linear with respect to xi, so I'm going to split with different drift, and then I'm going to put them together. I have again the same drift as before. But you see that here it's not true with the bounce. Okay, if I cut a gradient of u in two parts, and I take two bounce operators which each part, and I do the sum of the two operators, then the sum is not equal to a bounce with the complete gradient. Okay, so here I can. I can really define many different processes only from this method. So with some parts of the gradient which are given by drift and some parts of the gradient which are taken into account by possibly different bounces mechanism. So the first example would be the zigzag process, which can be seen as this. So you decompose the gradient on the canonical basis. Okay, so here you have d vector fields, which are not gradient, but never mind. So, and now you consider for each of these vector field, you consider a bounce mechanism. And so you have a process so that goes by straight lines, and each coordinate has some rate to be reflected, and since we are in dimension 1, each velocity is in that dimension 1, being reflected really means jumping from Vi to minus Vi. And so here you have a simulation from Joris Birkens, who defined and worked a lot on this zigzag. So you see that since you can only jump from Vi to minus Vi, in fact, what you can check that the velocity is always going, if you don't refresh, the velocity is just going to be so each coordinate is either minus 1 or 1, so you're going you'll always be on the diagonal directions, okay? And so you'll have some trajectory like that. Okay, another way to split things and to have new processes is to give this kind of context. So let's say your potential can be decomposed into two parts. One part is typically the short range interaction. So it's a part which is cheap numerically, but can be very high, and it can vary fastly. It can be singular. I'll give an example in a few seconds. And the other part is a slow part, bounded but numerically expensive. And so you would want to compute this part less often than the first one. Okay. So there are some multi-time step methods where you have different time steps for the first part and the second part, and you do things in some way. So in order to compute that, to compute the first one more often than the second. Okay, so let's take this example. So you take a mean field interaction with a Lennard-Jones interaction. So this is a singular potential. It looks like that. So this is a distance between two particles, and it's singular and repulsive at a small distance, and then it's weakly attractive far away. Okay, so you can decompose the potential with you take some cutoff ici, so some function C which is 1 for small r and then 0. So you cut your potential in two parts, so the short range 1 and the long range 1, and you see that the W is Lipschitz and going very fast to 0 for r large enough. So you will have this part that will be Lipschitz with a small Lipschitz constant, possibly. And you will have this part which is singular, but for short range interaction, you only jump with people which are close to you. And so long range interaction, you have n square interaction, but short range interaction, you only have a small number of neighbors. So if you keep a neighbor list that tells you at each time who is close to who, which is done in practice, for instance, in the molecular dynamics code, then you don't have to compute this part of the forces. You don't have to compute n square interaction. So you can hope to gain something like that. And so indeed, so you can decompose your forces like that. So you take all these parts and you put it in one potential which is going to be taken. Dealt with a drift operator, okay, and then you have the remaining part, which is maybe I don't go into detail, but just you do that by n square, so you have more or less n square interaction, and you use n square bounce mechanisms to deal with that, and you can in this toy model you can compute more or less. A numerical complexity for this. So if you do a classical method with some Euler, so just with let's say the kinetic Fokker Planck equation with some time step delta, and you count how many times you're going to compute the derivative of this potential, okay? because this is what is costly in this problem. And so, and if you do an experiment up to some time t, so at each time step you have to compute n square forces. So the whole complexity is this, and if you factorize as the potential like that, and if you use jumps, you can check that. So you, it's not completely trivial because you have to really see what is the cost for the jump process. And as I said, there is some thinning method here. So the question is your bound here, is it close to the real one? Is the one small? Is it costly to do that? So it's really problem dependent. Okay, it's not. There is no miracle. It's just if you give me any U, I can say okay, the good way to decompose the potentials is like that. You really have to understand the different forces here and how you are going to bound everything. But here, so you have the short range forces. So let's say that you have the number of neighbors for each particle is of order one. Well, anyway, it's negligible with respect to n, so you have something which is much smaller than tn squared over delta, and then you have the jumps. But since there is some 1 over n in front of the here it's mean field, so the forces is very small for large n, say. So each interaction is very small, and so you can gain an order in n, because you have to look at the constant. But anyway, we can see in this toy model that you can really gain some numerical complexity by decomposing things in a good way. Okay, so I conclude right now. So we are doing that with some chemists of the laboratory de chimie théorique. So in a real code with a real problem, so high dimensional things in molecular dynamics, and it looks like it works. Okay, so it's a work in progress, but we already have something which is as good as the current state of the art of multi-time step method, and we haven't optimized everything everywhere. As I said, it's efficient. Well, it seems to work, but you can't copy and pass to every new problem. You have to adapt your decomposition to your problem. Also, with Pierre Drazit and Mathias Rousset, currently we are doing an extrapolation from drift to Hamiltonian dynamics. So here we are in for Gaussian in dimension 2. Okay, this is the Hamiltonian dynamics. This is a jump process, and this is in between. So we have the parameter epsilon. Where epsilon is plus infinity, you have the bounce. When epsilon is zero, you have the drift, and you can just turn the button as you wish. So one of the motivations is that, okay, I said that we don't care about the real world because we are given a statistical target, and we just want to reproduce the statistical equilibrium, okay, whatever the dynamics of the process. But in fact, for some chemists, they really want to do a kinetic Fokker problem because they really believe in some sense that this is the system that they want to do, and then they don't only want statistical averages, they also want dynamical quantities. So they want to understand how many times you spend in some region before going to another place, and this really depends on your process. And so you really want to do the for instance the kinetic Fokker problem, but then you can't do the factorization trick, so you can't have some forces which are made by bounces, etc. But here, with that, we have a parameter which is exactly like the time step. So we can choose a compromise between I don't want to compute those forces too much, but on the other hand, I want to be close in some sense to the real continuous time dynamics. And so here, I can have several time steps, so it's not time steps, it's this parameter epsilon. I can have several epsilon, different epsilon, for different forces at different scales. And the difference with multi-time step method here is that, okay, the dynamical properties are not exactly the same, but the statistical properties are exact. Okay, so I can do something which looks like an Euler scheme for the continuous time process, except that this scheme has no bias on the statistical properties. Okay, and so these kind of things have been studied by people in physics from sampling and MCMC and things like that. Recently, there have been some quite a huge interest from people from Bayesian statistics, and so from a kinetic point of view, kinetic theory. So as I said, the Runner tumble, which is something which is of the same family. Okay, this is a kind of Runner tumble, have been studied, but I think that people from the kinetic theory could have some tools and maybe some ideas, even some. It could be interesting to try and understand how these processes. If you want to do the same thing with these processes at the kinetic focal plane, for instance, so you can look at the scaling limits or waves or whatever. Okay, so this is a new toy model, if you want, for all this question, because and some things are different. Okay, it's not a diffusion, so it's not, there is no regularity in some senses. So it looks like the Boltzmann, except that you have a non-constant rate. So there are some differences, but for instance, you would expect that you should be I don't know, but that should be some hope that you could have the same results as in the kinetic focal plane or in the Boltzmann focal plane, to have the small eigenvalues at a small temperature, so something more precise than what we had with couplings from before. Okay, and I think it's also those. Okay, so. So this is the paper of the physicist who first introduced the bouncy particle sampler, except that they didn't call it like that. This is my works about those kind of things. So there is many works by Birkens and co-authors about the zigzag process. So here this is really one of the first. So there is one paper before, but this is quite an introduction on that, and so there have been really these last 4 years there have been plenty of things everywhere, and here there was some review about what was going on. So this is quite a general introduction of this kind of thing, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions? Maybe I could just ask you a question. You consider these cases where you kind of split the potential in the different cases. Do you have some kind of toy example, maybe in two dimensions, where you can see which splitting is giving you what improvement compared to other methods?
For instance, well, in small d, it's difficult because everything is cheap, so I don't know, but the real example here is this time model. Okay, so here again, what happens is the following. So you have, let's say, I can do it without splitting with a short range and long range. Let's say that you have just a mean field interaction. And here, even I can have anything, something smooth, okay? So, xj minus xj. So, I have, see, if I decompose that in n square interaction, and I do bounces for all them, so I have n square reason to jump, but the jump is at rate 1 over n, because the force, the Lipschitz, okay, the jumps will come from the Lipschitz constant of this guy, so there is a 1 over n, so I will propose jumps at a rate 1 over n, and I will propose n square of them. And so, if I do the simulation for a given time, so you have n square Poisson processes with rate 1 over n, so on average you will have t n jumps. Okay, and each time you have one jump, you have to compute only one time w prime. Okay, so to do the simulation for time 0 to t, you have tn times the computation of this guy. And if you do the same with a time step, you have tn square over delta, which is your time step. And so you see that you win if the... Okay, you win one order of n and the time step also. So it's hidden in the fact that there is a constant here, but you can, in this toy model, you can really win a lot.
So regarding the Kramers formula, in higher dimension, the Kramers formula.
Yeah.
So if I understand well, you don't get even the exponential rate of what you expect.
Yeah, because it's difficult. We should have the same, but okay. If you are in any dimension, okay, let's say in dimension 2, I want to escape from here, and typically what should be expected is that the process escapes from the saddle point with the lower energy barrier, and that tells you that essentially the process goes there. But what we did in our case is just to completely forget the potential, to say, okay, I have two different guys at two different points, and I can couple them in some way to have the same velocity at the same time at some point, and then we are saying, okay, now there is some probability that in the meanwhile, now we put again the potential, but there is some probability that there is no bounce during the attempt to do that. Because if there is a bounce, we are going to define the velocities in such a way that they are going to go there, but at some point, well, for instance here, if this guy is in the local minimum, what will happen is that it's going to go there, and in fact it's going to be reflected, so it's never going to reach there. But there is some probability to go from here to here, and it's exponentially bad. Okay, it's the probability to go to overcome this energy barrier, which is not the correct one, which is escaping from a saddle point with a lower energy barrier. And so, if we want to have a trajectorial understanding on how to have the correct theta here, we should consider a trajectory which is broken lines but going through low energy saddle point. And so this now this is more complicated than what we did.
Okay, then let's thank the speaker again.